Now, yesterday, we showed you these gorgeous pictures of our even more gorgeous colleague, Narelda, on the cover and in the pages of Sunday Life magazine.
Yeah, all glammed up there, looking like a model, to be
Louis
honest.
Vuitton,
like
that was. Model. Louis Vuitton, head to toe.
But you know what?
Did you put the boots in your handbag? Tell me you did.
They were really hard to take off, and I was like, oh, no, I'm going to have to leave with them on.
Keep them.
But behind that beautiful photo shoot is such an incredible story, and I don't feel like we gave it the time it deserved yesterday because we were so enamoured by your beautiful photos. But you have lived so much life, lady. Well, starting with falling pregnant at 18,
yeah,
getting married, mm, and then being divorced.
It was a really tumultuous couple of years, and to be able to understand where the wedding came from at 18, you need to kind of understand a bit of my sort of family background. My dad was a reverend of the Uniting Church, and my mum was also a pastor, and that's how they met through church. There's my beautiful parents there, Margaret and Cedric, and so when you know, my boyfriend at the time sat down with my mum. I couldn't kind of face my dad, and told her that we were having a baby. She thought we were joking. Mum thought we were joking, and you know, it wasn't a joke. And the smile kind of gave way to tears. And we got married 3 months after that. We were married 3 months after that.
A shotgun wedding.
Yes.
To do the right thing.
It was a shotgun wedding. There I am, heavily. So the wedding had to come, you know, before I was showing too much. That's 3 months. So there I am as an 18-year-old getting married.
It was a beautiful, can we say?
It was a big shebang. But I kind of look at that photo and I kind of see just someone going through the motions.
Yeah.
You know, doing what we needed to do and be in front of all of our family and loved ones. The right thing to do. Yeah. So little wonder that 6 months after Jade was born, we separated. It didn't work out. Yeah.
How do you bring yourself back from something like that? I'm looking at these photos of you with Jade. You're a baby yourself.
Yeah.
To have a baby, be married and divorced before you're even out of your teenage years.
I know, but look at that kid, will ya? She's so beautiful.
But you've obviously dug deep to find some sort of grit and resilience to build yourself back up to become, you know. Well, a star of the TV.
Yeah. Oh,
I mean, how did that happen?
On my family. I really lent on my family. I've got four older sisters and they're all amazing and they're all really strong, powerful women. My mum is a strong, powerful force as well, who's had quite a lot of influence over my life, which is why I didn't come out until I was about 21, 22, because of that, you know, Christianity, gays were going to hell, AIDS was brought by God as punishment for the gays. You know, that's how I grew up. That's how we grew up, thinking all of those things. And so I buried my sexuality so deeply deep down and was closeted for the longest time until I met some friends in my workplace, the Commonwealth Public Service at the Native Title Tribunal, where I started as a receptionist and then worked my way into the media unit. And there were some lesbians that worked there as well, and we became quite good friends, and they took me out to the Court Hotel in Perth, which is a legendary rainbow venue, queer venue, and that's kind of where my eyes were opened, I guess.
How did you struggle with that duality, and how did you tell your parents that you were gay?
Well, again, came a very hard conversation, and it was after my first partner, Marion, we'd been together 3 years. And we hid it from my family.
Did they think she was just a friend?
Yes. You know, that's why The Happiest Season, that movie, speaks to so many people, because we've all had friends that have come for Christmas. We've all had orphaned friends that have come for Christmas. And Marion was always invited to our family functions. In fact, she was thought of as another sister, I guess, because she also looked like us. But after 3 years, I realised I can't live closeted. I can't hide this anymore. And so I sat my mum down. Again, I couldn't, you know, face my dad. And sat my mum down and told her. And then, you know, then the tears came. And my mum said, well, how long has this been going on? I said, 3 years. And she said, well, that's a lot to undo, isn't it? And what is so fortunate was that she said to me, you know, I'll never be able to accept your sexuality, but I will always love you. So that was the best thing that I could have heard from my mum, because so many other people are ostracised from their family, are kicked out, never to see them again, or placed into conversion therapy. And that's why it's so important now that conversion therapy is outlawed, because who gives someone the right to say, we need to fix you? You know, you can't love that person. We need to fix you.
When there's nothing wrong with
you. There is nothing wrong.
Is it harder to do stuff like for yourself or stuff for other people? Because when you got married essentially for other people, you know, which was very quite difficult.
Yes, I see what you mean, because you can champion other people.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you have to call something out yourself, and this is what I'm still grappling with as a 45-year-old, because this came to a head, you know, while I've been co-hosting Mardi Gras with Joel Creasy. And I'm so proud of being able to, you know, lend a voice to Mardi Gras and commentate Mardi Gras, you know, on a
Courtney
asked
her to say hello the other day. She, was in, she was in the studio. Yeah. She's like, say hello to my girl.
Yeah, love Courtney and Zoe Coombs-Marr as well. We're a team. We're a team, unstoppable team now. But, yeah, so proud and happy and excited to do Mardi Gras and then to get on the phone to my mum and for her to express her disappointment.
How do you live that? How do you kind of...
Well, we've reached a compromise over the years where we just don't talk about it. We know that our marriage equality votes cancelled each other out. Mm. She's never going to come to the party with my sexuality. She's never going to accept it. We have limited conversations about my relationships and the things that, you know, Mardi Gras and that sort of stuff. I know she'll be disappointed about it this year when it comes up in just a few weeks' time. I have learnt not to talk about it with her. She does sometimes express her disappointment still.
Has she met Stevie?
She's met Stevie. And, look, I have to also say that my mum has come a long way in that... she will ask about Stevie.
Yeah.
Although she sometimes calls her Steffi. But, I think any mum does that, though, yeah. Don't they? But she'll ask about Stevie and you know, how are you both? And so that's kind of come a long way. And we can be affectionate in front of each other. Like, I can put my arm around Stevie and that sort of thing.
So when something like this beautiful article in Sunday Life comes out, has your mum seen that yet? Has there been a reaction?
No, I haven't spoken to her about it. And I did talk about my mum a bit in that article. And also I didn't hear from my mum about the Women's Weekly shoot either, because for that very reason, because it's just a bit too much for her to take. But, you know, the compromise is that I want to have a relationship with my mum. I love my mum.
Of course.
She's been... she's such a support for me, you know, career-wise. She's had very wise words to tell me over the years that has made me stick at it when I've wanted to kind of give it up.
Sorry, you're making me want to cry. I'm so sorry.
No,
I'm so
I do. And I love my mum and I wouldn't want to give that up for anything. And I'm just... I have her love. And that's everything to me.
But to live bravely and to live your life, that's huge, and that's what I just took away from your article yesterday.
Oh,
that you to stand in your truth.
Thank you.
Yeah. And that, sorry, just the whole mum thing made me really sad.
Well, look, I don't share this to air our dirty laundry in any way, you know. But it's to help people. It's to help other people.
There would be. I was just thinking that exact same thing. There would be other people in the exact same situation as you.
Yeah.
Where that relationship with their parent is still vital and crucial. So you have to find some way to navigate it.
Yeah. You know, I've got a nephew who's very out and proud, and during the marriage equality debate, it really came to a head for our family because it was divided, because there's a very strong Christian element of some of my sisters as well. And it really divided the family. And that's why the marriage equality debate should not have happened, because it divided families and it divided the country. You know, we're just happy that, you know, 64% or however many people, 67% voted yes. And now, look, it doesn't affect the people who voted no in any way.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's why also we need to extend it and to... really limit the religious discrimination bills that are afoot and being debated now, because we shouldn't allow hate speech to be allowed because it impacts people's lives in such a strong way that they feel they're not worthy, that they feel that they need to be fixed because that's what they're told and that's what society deems acceptable. It's not acceptable to say those things. It's hate speech and it needs to be stamped out, and we need to, you know, not discriminate. There's, you know, transphobia, homophobia doesn't have a place in Australia. Neither does racism and discrimination and all those things. And yeah, we just need to.
Do you have to go? Those photos are beautiful, but even more beautiful is your heart, your words, and just that soul of yours, and just your strength.
Oh,
you know.
I haven't read it yet. I tell you why. The funny thing is because I haven't been here long, like, you know, but I barely know anything about you, any of you. Like, you know what I mean? So it's. not to say every time I see you on a magazine and I go, buy it, or read the paper and stuff, but I'm interested in it because I don't know you. Mm. You know what I mean? I don't know you either. No, you a little bit.
Yeah, we're kind of talking about things. Nice to meet you.
But that's fascinating, and I appreciate being around you guys like that. Yeah. What I'm always interested in knowing is when you do open up about certain things that you've gone through, do you then, are you almost compromised in a place then where you feel like you're being, you have to go to bat for everybody? Do you know what I mean?
Like, then become it's a funny one then. Poster girl.
Yeah, because I find any time we talk about Enton Aboriginal, Enton gay, we go, oh, the one around things.
But you can't waste a platform.
Yeah. Oh, no, I get that. You know, I get that.
And that's what it comes down to. You know, I feel like I have a responsibility as any Indigenous person, as any queer person does, if they've got a platform, they have a responsibility because we are standing on the shoulders of the people who've gone before. And now we have the ears of the country to listen and the ears of the world, and we've got to use it, like Grace Tame says. Yeah.